Thank you for the introduction, and thank you for having me. It's genuinely lovely to be here, and I already have a sticker, which I'm told means I'm part of the club now. Yes, I'm involved. So I'm Tom. I work at Habito. I tweet quite a lot. All the code I'm going to show is on GitHub, and my blog's at the bottom. If you know who I am, it will be because of this, because it's about the only useful thing I've ever contributed. And what it was is I wrote a series of blog posts about this specification in JavaScript called the Fantasyland specification. It had this stupid pun as a title, which I thought was really funny when I wrote the first post, and then people started picking it up, and it got popular, and then for the 20 posts I ended up writing, I had to stick with it. So, fantasy land specification, you're welcome. And basically all it is in vanilla JavaScript, going through everything you'd need to know to be a Haskell programmer. There's nothing beyond this. And in fact, by the time you get down to CommonAd, you're beyond most industry Haskell programmers. It's not something we do a lot. And I say we because I work at Habito. I'm fully branded, and don't worry, I even brought extra shirts. So, and what we do is we're a digital mortgage broker, which isn't very interesting. What's interesting about it is everything on the server side is written in Haskell, which is the logo on the left, and everything on the actual website is written in PureScript. There's no smoke and mirrors. It's a purely functional application from end to end, which is cool. Because people don't believe it. I think you get a lot of companies that say we have this kind of side project in the attic that's written in Haskell and like one guy knows how it works, but no one else has a clue. And it's not like that. We have about 20 people who know how it works and no one else has a clue. So who knows what this is? Does anyone recognize this game? This is Super Hexagon, and my idea for this talk was to try to build a very, very, very simplified version of it in PureScript, just to prove you can do useful things. And what I came up with, which is hopefully on the next slide, you can actually play here, just to show off. I'm gonna click this. So we've got this little thing. I'm genuinely pressing arrow keys, I'm not lying. And so all I can do is turn left and right, and as I get through an obstacle, the thing gets slightly faster, picks a random direction. We'll see later it's not quite random. It just gets faster, right? And eventually it gets too fast and you lose and your score goes back to zero. I haven't written a scoreboard or anything really. This is basically it. Just to prove the concept. So, let's go back. And to do that, I wanted to talk about proactive and reactive behaviors. And firstly, reactive behaviors. This is a thing I think people are used to. So if you've ever worked with Rx or anything like that, the idea is that you're listening for something to happen, like something's clicked or someone types in something or moves the mouse or whatever. And when it happens, you respond to it in a particular way. And it's usually asynchronous because that's the only way it's useful if you want to listen for events like user interaction. And it kind of makes sense as a stream. If you imagine it as an infinite array of things that might happen, and all you're doing is doing whatever you're doing to all of them in a long go. And I did write some JavaScript, just to prove I still can, down there. And all it does is say, every time I click the mouse, I just want you to log the event that's triggered. So I just clicked in a few places, and as you can see, that's listening for an event. So I'm going to call it a reactive behavior, because it reacts to what's happening. And in PureScript, we have this idea of behaviors, or proactive behaviors. I wrote traitor because Phil Freeman, who built the library, is from Yorkshire and forgot the U. Moves to LA and just stops caring. Horrible. And behaviors are a bit odd, because what you're actually doing is saying, over and over and over again, what's the state of this thing? So let's say you've got, I'm going to come back to this example later. Let's say you've got pressing the arrow keys, like we do in this game. An event is like, every time you press an arrow key, do this thing. A behavior is more like, which arrow keys are being pressed now? And I'm just going to keep asking that question. And every time I ask that question, I want you to do something. So usually, under the hood, it's request animation frame, basically. Just do it fast enough that no one can tell. It's just jumping from frame to frame. And I left off the type because it's really ugly, but this is kind of it, this line. If you have a behavior of integers, if you can give me a function from integer to whatever you like, I can just keep giving it integers. I'll get them from somewhere. So I don't know what you'd say. It's like a description of a supply of things, which is ugly. So I went for a function of time. Like, how do the keys I'm pressing change over time? That's the thing I want to talk about. And when you put them side by side, it becomes much clearer to see what the difference is. So like we said, key pressed is very much an event, but which keys are currently being pressed is a behavior. Similarly, I can say set interval 100, and every tenth of a second, something will be triggered. But it's still reactive, right? I'm still listening for a particular moment in time. Whereas in behaviors, I can just say, what's the time now? And all it will do is keep calling that function, keep giving it new data, and keep doing whatever I tell it to do. Similarly, mouse moved is reactive. Current mouse position is proactive. Every time I move the mouse, I want you to tell me where it is. In general, an event is something happened, and a behavior is this is what something's doing right now. And that's kind of it. But how do we use them? Because it's a weird concept, right? We're presumably comfortable with events and how they work. We're attaching listeners, and then whenever it happens, you know, things kick off. But how do we use behaviors? And so I started with this. Pursuit is the PureScript Google, basically. If you want a function in PureScript, you can go to Pursuit. You can write down the name of it and find it. You can even write down the type of it. You say, I don't know what I need, but it's got this type. And it'll say, well, here are all the things you could use. And one of the ones you find is this thing, keys. And it is, can I move away from the mic? Is that fine?
To breathe.
So it's a behavior of something, just in the same way that you have an array of something or a promise of something. And in particular, it's a behavior of a set of ints. What a set is, for people who don't know, is it's a unique collection of things, so in this case, integers. So you can't have duplicates, and there's no concept of ordering. So all we can really do is add something to it, check if something's there, and pull it back out. That's basically all we have. And so I wrote a little bit of PureScript, and if this seems alien, we will go through it step by step. Show of hands, who's done any Elm? So you three won't need help. So we have a few things going on here. First of all, we've made up a new type, which we do with this data word called controls. Should have called it directions, didn't realize until I was sat at the back. of either anti-clockwise or clockwise, because that's the only two things we can do, right? We can move right and left. And then what we do here is we say, if we have that set of ins, we do one of these things. So we call them guards. It's more like, what do you have, switch and default at the end. So if 37 is in that set of keys, which is a left arrow key, go anti-clockwise. Otherwise, if 39 is a member of that set of keys, go clockwise. Otherwise, don't do anything. And I'm going to gloss over maybe, but basically it's how we encode the idea of nullable. So rather than having a null value that can go wrong, we actually say it's either just something or nothing. And it all works out fine because they have the same interface, which we'll talk about in a bit. But the problem becomes, we don't have a set of numbers. We don't have the set of keys. We've got a behavior of the set of keys. And we want to take that not to maybe a control, but a behavior of maybe controls, i.e., for every single moment that we care in this behavior, what are they trying to do? So I've written three question marks. Does anyone know what this function is? Good. What if I write it like this? So for any A and B you can possibly imagine, if you can give me a function from A to B, I can kind of lift that into a behavior A to a behavior B. Cool. So you already do this. It's called map. And what's interesting is it's way more general than behaviors. In fact, what we say here is, if f is a functor, don't worry too much, we can take an fa to an fb, so an f with an a inside it to an f with b inside it, if we have this function. I say you've all done it before because array map is a perfect example. If I have a function from a to b and an array of a's, I can get an array of b's. I just call it on every method. So this is one of the things I think you learn very early on when you write Haskell or something, is that the notion of a container of things is way more general than you might first expect. And map is almost universally, I want to do something to the thing inside this container. So actually all we do is we say map keys to controls over keys, and then it's done. We've gone from having set ints to maybe controls to a behavior of set int to a behavior of maybe controls. Don't worry too much about the type signatures. What's important is controls, keep this in your mind, is a behavior of maybe controls. But that's not all we want to do. We have two things we care about, at least for now. We care about which keys are being pressed, and we care about what time it is, because the time is going to tell us how to shrink, how to move, how quickly we should be moving. So we need that number. We need some way of getting to it. And we hit a problem in that it's also not a number. It's a behavior of numbers. So let's think of this function. All this does, again, running away from the mic, take a number and a set of ints and put it in an object, plain old JavaScript object. You can write it like this. You can write it like this. You can even write it like this. Whatever you want. All does the same thing. But we have a problem. We can't map, because we're not applying that function to one behavior, we're applying it to two. So the question becomes, how do we write this function? How do we say, I've got two behaviors that have nothing to do with each other, and I want to smush them together. I want access to both A and B at the same time, and I'll do something, I'll make up another thing. This is for any A, B, and C you can possibly imagine. I will do something with A and B and get a C. So I'm doing something involving both. And this is a function called lift2, which is a much better name than map, because what it does is it says, give me a function and I will lift it over behaviors, over arrays, whatever else. If you're interested, this does something really cool for arrays. What lift2 does is say, do everything in the first array and do everything in the second, but like, I don't want to say Cartesian product, it's a nested for loop, right? It's for everything in the first, for everything in the second, do a thing. So a nested for loop becomes app. This already exists. It's already an interface that's, I promise, really useful. And the kind of continued joy of Haskell is everything basically looks the same. You don't have to learn a lot. So we're here, right? We've got these maybe controls. Now remember, this is a behavior of maybe controls. It's important. And we've got this function that takes maybe controls to a number. How do we apply it? We map. We learned that just a few minutes ago. So that's cool. We've now got this move thing, which is like every animation frame, you're going to say -1, 0, or 1. That's not massively useful. What we want to do is say add up all the numbers that have ever happened and keep a kind of state. Here's where I'm going to lose a few people, and I am sorry. We're just going to gloss over it and not think too much about it. So, what fix does is give you access to yourself as a behavior, which is really weird. So, fix says, give me an initial state, which here is 0, and a function from you to an extension of you. Or in this case, all we're doing, which is really kind of underwhelming, is we're saying add whatever comes in the move stream to whatever we just had. If you don't understand, don't worry. You never need to look at it again. If you write PureScript, you can say, pos is there and there. We don't need to write it. and you get this beautiful partial application. Isn't that lovely? Thanks, man. So that's a Unicode error and behaviors, sort of. Which is kind of half the battle, right? I promise, using only map and app, we can build this entire application's interaction. The only thing we actually have left to do is draw the pictures, right? The pretty things. So how do we draw static shapes? It's really dull. You want a filled object, the fill color is white, and it's a rectangle starting at 0, 0, going down to 400, 400, which, as will become clear later, is the size of the entire thing. This is the background. Anyone who's worked with the HTML canvas knows it doesn't clear automatically. You have to draw over whatever's already there. So if we do that, we get this.
Wow.
Thank you. Good. Which is what we want, right? Still not very interesting. And actually, what I do in this code is I also draw the guideline, which is like the gray circle your dot moves along. And all that is an outlined circle. It's got this gray tone thing, who cares? It's a circle that lives in the middle of the screen, 200, 200, right in the middle, radius 50. Now, there's this thing, which is a weird foreign operator we've never seen before. And if you do maths, this is called semi-group appending, which is a terrifying name for smushing things together. So actually all I'm saying is I have this backdrop thing, and I have this guideline thing, and I want both. That's what we call it append does. It literally appends one thing to another. It's so boring. And we can do kind of massy things. I realized when I finished this game, I should have picked Snake or something that didn't involve quite so much trigonometry, because that's gonna detract. But we'll power through. So here we're rotating around. Don't worry about it. We're rotating the obstacle, and then we're translating it to the middle of the screen. Now this is semi-groupoid composition, or in English, function composition. You do this thing, you take this drawing, you apply it to here, you follow the arrow, and then you do this thing. So it's just applying one function to the result of applying one function to the thing you give it. I'm going to translate the rotation of a drawing. Nothing else. Writing text? Absolutely. So here, someone might have noticed it's got the little score in the top right. And all I do is say, if you give me the value, the score value, I'm going to show it, which is turn it into a string, and then I'm going to color it black, I'm going to put it here, and it's going to be monospace 12 with nothing special. Mempty is a monoidal identity, and what that means in English is nothing, as in literally nothing. So this is a fun one. I will show the page later. Basically, the styling you can do to text in PureScript is what we call a monoid. And what that means is you can have bold, you can have italic, you can smush them together using that little thing, semi-group append, or you can have none of them, and that's mempty. And what mempty means is if I apply nothing to anything else, that anything else doesn't change. It's just the kind of the null. It's the identity is what we call it. It's like the ID function. I give it a thing, I just get it back. And that's drawing, that's kind of it. And there's another Unicode error. And that's everything we need. So let's look at docs, because I promised I wasn't gonna make it up. So these are the, let's not do that. Let's do the font function.
Can I zoom in a bit?
Oh yes, yeah, absolutely. Is that okay? Are we good?
Yeah.
So this is the function in PureScript drawing. I picked this library because a nice name. And if we open it up, it says I need a font family, a number, which is the size, some font options, and I'm going to give you a font. And what can you do with a font? You can, wherever it lives, you're in here somewhere. Maybe you're not. No, I know where you are. You're in here. You can call the text function, and you can say, I want my text to have this font. And then I want to know where it is, and I want to know how to fill it in. And of course, what the text actually says is the important bit. Right there at the end, much later than it should be. And then I'll give you a drawing. I'll draw some text for you. And the reason this is cool, the reason this is exciting, is because if we go and look at font options, we'll see it has this thing called EQ, which means if you give me two options, I can tell if they're the same. It has this thing called semigroup, which means I can smush them together. And it has this thing called monoid, which means I can do nothing. Which is great. Almost always what we want to do. And that's kind of it. The other thing I was going to show is, if you decide to mess around with this, just search for behavior without the U. Thanks, Phil. And you'll find this library with all its bits, a couple of keyboard commands. You can listen for a specific key if that's more your thing. Got the mouse position, which buttons are being pressed. It's just a trackpad. It's only got one. And even time, like milliseconds since 1970, and seconds is what I use. And you put this all together, and you get this, which I think is pretty cool. So the last thing I'm going to do is scare you all. I copied and pasted it into this thing called TriPureScript, which is like it's an online interactive editor. So I mean, just to prove if you get one of these names wrong, it breaks. It's literally live. It's happening right now, real time. So what's interesting? As I say, a lot of maths. No one cares about this. Hopefully this is maths scary and not PureScript scary, right? Collision detection's ugly. It's never not going to be. Like, there isn't a good language for collision detection. But this is the interesting one. So when I update every render frame, I'm going to need the timestamp, I'm going to need the control you're pressing, and I'm going to need what the state used to be. Based on that, I can do this, which I think is quite pretty. If I set off the next obstacle, and the cursor happens to be in the way of the last one, and the cursor isn't in the way of the last one, add one to my score. If it is, my score is zero. I've lost. And otherwise, scores as it was. And then once you've got that, and state, by the way, lives here, that's all I know, what the time is, where the cursor is, how much the game is rotated, and the current score, I can use that to paint the picture. And it is just semi-group. I want the background, and then I want the score, and then I want to rotate the combination of the cursor and the obstacle. And it's just append them all together. It's beautiful. And that was docs and code. So I am now out of slides, so I'll say thank you very much, and does anyone have any questions?